network, as you say. In our language, I would try to explain a few minutes before that both art and science had a main base as a transcendence. One professor from Mostar here, Professor Duraković, tried to explain that there's no by any chance prediction how or will some person be creative. So that Miss Sabina mentioned before, that both sides of the brain cooperate and collaborate to bring something new. So the art is always something new, it's part of the process, as science as a part of the process also, bringing something new to the humanity and society. It was great pleasure for our gallery to host the exhibition a few weeks ago, which presented student artworks and photographies of this space and photographies of nebulas and different kinds of space photographies. Approach to those photographs was scientific, but students, during the workshop that we had in our gallery, they presented their approach to what should or what could possibly be creative kind of approach and appearance of space. So thank you once again. I was really happy to be a part of the network. Thank you once again. And I would like to propose ourselves to further cooperation here in Mostar.
Okay, thank you, Dalibor. Thank you all panelists. And now Mihail and Ivica will take over and please surprise us.
Okay, so hi everyone. Greetings from Split, from Croatia. I will, now we will start with this virtual visit, but the first thing that I will do, I will give you a brief introduction to the CMS detector and the physics that we are doing here, just for you, all of you, to understand better what is the global concept and what exactly we are doing with this experiment. I will give this introduction in Croatian, which is one of our local languages, and we perfectly understand each other in all these languages. And then we will switch to English, and then Mihail will, with Peja, I think, they will actually guide us through the CMS detector, as you will see in, on the surface and below the surface where the CMS detector is really situated on. So let me now switch to Croatian. Dobar dan svima. Ja ću sada najprije, kao što sam rekao, da ću vam jedan kratki uvod u fiziku čestica, šta mi u biti radimo na CERN-u. I onda to će trajati jedno 15 minuta i nakon toga ćemo onda započeti sa posjetom CMS detektoru. Ovaj uvod je zbog toga da bi bolje razumijeli kad budete vidjeli o čemu se radi, da bi bolje sve zajedno razumijeli. So this introduction will last for 15 minutes. I apologize to those of you which are not fluent in our local languages, but I guess that you will also understand most of it. So let me now share the slides. Dakle, sad ću podijeliti slajdove i onda ćemo se pozabaviti posjetom. Dakle,
stand off. Well, I didn't touch anything. So now you can talk.
Mihail,
yes.
Maybe you can mute.
yes. I mean, just before you start, because I will get ready to fetch my helmet. I will go down, just to explain you. I will go down with Noemi. And we will.
No, you stay. You have to stay. Please.
Okay. Noemi goes down.
You will see and you will.
Noemi goes down and presents us. I will. The live feed. Okay.
Okay, good. Okay. So let me now give you a brief introduction to the CMS detector and to the particle physics. And the global picture, what are we doing exactly? So let me now share the screen. Okay. Just a second. Okay. Sada, Dakle, ovo što vidite je slika CMS detektora koji se sastoji od detektora i od ljudi, kao što ćete vidjeti, ljudi su jako bitni u cijeloj toj priči. Ovo u pozadini je zaista CMS detektor u svojoj prirodnoj veličini, ali ovo je fotografija koju je napravio upravo Mihael, naš prijatelj i kolega koji je sada s nama. A cijeli detektor se nalazi dolje 100 metara ispod zemlje, a ovo na slici je 10% kolaboracije koja upravlja ovim detektorom. Mi se tu i tamo sastanemo na CERN-u i ovdje smo se jedan put sastali pa smo se slikali. Ali samo 10%, dakle nas ima više od 3000. A osobno tome ćemo reći nešto malo kasnije. Dakle, najopćenitija moguća slika koju možete zamisliti je ova. Ovo je model razvoja svemira od samog početka do danas. Ono što mi danas znamo je da je svemir star 13,8 milijardi godina. Mi mislimo da je on započeo u velikom prasku, a mi se danas nalazimo 13,8 milijardi godina od samog početka. I naravno, kad god vidite ovakvu sliku svemira, svemir se od samog početka, od kad je nastao, se širi i dan danas se širi i vjerojatno će se tako i širiti u budućnosti. Ali kad vidite ovu sliku, odmah se zapitate kako mi ovo znamo. I postoje dva načina na koje mi ispitujemo svemir. Prvi način se svodi na to da krenete od danas i gledate unazad. Jer vi kad vidite, recimo, vi kad vidite sve stvari oko sebe, u ovom trenutku ih vidite u prošlosti. Zato što svjetlosti treba neko vrijeme da od svih tih stvari oko vas dođe do vas i ruku na srce vi nikad stvari ne vidite sada, nego uvijek malo prije. Samo što u svakodnevnom životu to malo prije je malo, to je tipa nanosekunde. Ali kad gledate nebeska tijela, to i nije baš tako malo. Naprimjer, kad gledate mjesec, vidite ga kako izgleda prije jedne sekunde. Jer svjetlosti treba jedna sekunda da od mjeseca dođe do vas. Kad gledate sunce, vidite ga kako izgledalo prije 8 minuta. Jer svjetlosti treba 8 minuta da dođe od sunca do vas. Kad gledate najbližu zvijezdu suncu, zove se Proxima Centauri, udaljena je 4 godine, 4 svjetlosne godine. To znači da je vi gledate kako izgledala prije 4 godine, a ne sada. Kad gledate Andromedu, koja je najbliža galaksija našoj galaksiji, ona je udaljena od nas 2,5 miliona svjetlosnih godina. Što znači da kad je vi gledate na nebu, vidite je kako je izgledala prije 2,5 miliona godina. Ne sada, nego prije 2,5 miliona godina. I tako gledajući objekte u svemiru, mi u biti gledamo unazad. I tim područjem fizike se bave astrofizika i kozmologija. I tako smo mi saznali kako izgleda svemir gledajući unazad. Ali granica do koje možemo doći je kad je svemir bio star 380 tisuća godina. Dakle, od početka do 380 tisuća godina i mi unazad možemo gledati sve do tog trenutka. A zašto ne možemo prije toga na ovakav način? Zato što je svemir prije toga bio neproziran. To je isto kao kad gledate oblake. Vi kad gledate oblake, vi vidite samo prednju stranu oblaka, ne vidite unutar oblaka, jer je unutar neprozirno. Svjetlo se odbija od prednje strane. Tako se ovdje svjetlost odbija u biti od ove granice kad je svemir bio star 380 tisuća godina. A sad je pitanje, kako mi znamo što se dogodilo prije 380 tisuća godina? Jer znamo mi od 0 do 380 tisuća što se dogodilo? I slušajte sad ovo. Ovo je jedno od najspektakularnijih spoznaja svih vremena. A to je, mi vam znamo što se dogodilo ne jednu sekundu od samog početka, ne niti mikrosekundu, dakle milionni dio jedne sekunde od početka, mi vam znamo šta se dogodilo milionni dio jednog miliontnog dijela jedne sekunde od samog početka svemira. Zamislite to. Dakle, počeo svemir, još nije prošla jedna sekunda, nije još ni miliontni dio sekunde, nego miliontni dio jednog miliontnog dijela jedne sekunde. E to znamo. I od tad do danas sve znamo što se dogodilo. Ono što ne znamo je od nula do tog milijontnog dijela jedne sekunde. A najluđe od svega je, znate kako to znamo? To znamo zato što smo to ponovo napravili. Mi smo ponovo, i to baš u ovome o čemu danas pričamo, u srcu našeg detektora, koji ćete vi danas vidjeti, mi smo u njemu sudarajući protone, u velikom sudaraču hadrona u Ženevi, mi smo sudarajući te protone ponovo stvorili uvjete kakvi su vladali kad je svemir bio star milijontni dio jednog milijontnog dijela jedne sekunde od samog početka. mi smo praktički ponovo stvorili, te rekreirali taj praktički početni trenutak svemira. I danas ćemo vam o tom biti pričati. I naš detektor služi kao neka vrsta kamere koja gleda šta se tada dogodilo. E sad, dakle, to je ono što radi LHC. Ovo 10 na minus 12 sekundi, to je ono što sam ja nazvao milijontni dio milijontnog dijela jedne sekunde. To se u našem jeziku zove 10 na minus 12 sekundi. To je 0,1101 jedinica na kraju sekundi od samog početka svemira. Ok, e sad, mi sve što znamo o prirodi danas, najfundamentalnija, to jest najosnovnija stvar koju znamo o prirodi, se svodi na, mi smo ga saželi, u nešto što se zove standardni model fundamentalnih čestica i njihovih interakcija. A to vam ukratko kaže ovo, sad to je vrlo kratko, ja nema puno vremena za ovo. A to je, svijet se sastoji od 12 čestica i 12 antičestica. Čestice su podijeljene u dvije obitelji, jedno se zovu leptoni, drugo se zovu kvarkovi, a antičestice u antileptone i antikvarkove. Ovih ima 12, ovih ima 12. Zašto ih ima 12? Iskreno govoreći, ne znamo. Zašto postoje ove antičestice? I to ne znamo. Zašto su te antičestice nestale? I to ne znamo. Ima puno toga što mi ne znamo, ali to je dobra vijest za nas, jer ćemo istražiti, pa ćemo jednog dana i naučiti. Ove čestice od ovih kvarkova vam se grade protoni i neutroni, a protoni i neutroni čine jezgre atoma, još vam treba elektron i onda se cijeli svijet u biti izgradi od ovih čestica. I od njih se izgrade atomi, od atoma se gradi sve ostalo i dobijete cijeli svijet oko nas. Druga, i to je jedan koncept prirode, to je jedan sastojak prirode. Drugo su sile u prirodi. Ove čestice djeluju jedne na druge nekim silama. Vi ste naučili, recimo, dvije sile koje svi znate, zovu se elektromagnetska i gravitacija. A postoje još dvije sile u prirodi, jedna se zove jaka nuklearna, a druga se zove slaba nuklearna sila. To su četiri sile u prirodi. Ova jaka nuklearna i slaba nuklearna, one su vam sadržene u atomima, pa tamo djeluju i tako dalje, pa ih mi ne vidimo u svakodnevnom životu, ali mi u svakodnevnom životu vidimo elektromagnetsku, koja upravlja našim životima, jer sve što se događa u našim životima, sve je elektromagnetska sila. I možete slobodno, kada vas neko optužuje da ste vi odgovorni za nešto, možete slobodno reći da niste vi, nego elektromagnetska sila. Jer ruku na srce, ona upravlja svime. A još jedna je gravitacija koja upravlja cijelim svemirom, zato što ona djeluje na velikoj skali. E, ono što je zanimljivo, ako ovu jaku silu proglasimo da je njena snaga 1, onda je elektromagnetska 100 puta slabija, slaba sila je 100.000 puta slabija, a gravitacijska je, pa ste sad, 40 redova veličine slabija. Ne 40 puta, nego 10 sa 40 nula puta slabija od ove godine. A svejedno upravlja svemirom. Jer zašto je uvijek privlačno. Ali ok, to je druga priča. E sad, još jedna stvar koja je zanimljiva. Mi smo vam, ima jedno od 20 godina, saznali jednu stvar, a to je da cijeli svemir vidljivi, sve što vidite oko sebe, sve galaksije i sve zvijezde, da je to sve zajedno 5% svemira. I to je ono što mi zovemo normalna materija. A da 27% svemira se zove tamna materija za koju nemamo uopće pojma šta je. A 68% svemira je takozvana tamna energija za koju ne da ne znamo što je, nego ne čak malo i neugodno reći toga. Sve o svemu, mi znamo za 95%, mi znamo samo za 5% svemira, a 95% svemira uopće ne znamo o čemu se radi. Mi smo vam znanstvenici čudni ljudi. Mi bi rekli čudne beštije ovdje u Dalmaciji. Zato što mi kad nešto ne znamo, mi smo najsretniji, jer to znači da moramo istraživati i onda ćemo mi istraživati. Vidjet ćete malo kasnije što ćemo. Dakle, kad bi sve ovo što sam vam ja rekao i čime se u biti mi se bavimo ispitivanjem standardnog modela i traženja nečega što se ne uklapa u taj standardni model. I taj standardni model bi se mogao prikazati kao jedna tablica, to je ovih 12 čestica, 12 antičestica, 4 sile i takozvani Higgsov bozon. To je sad jedna specijalna stvar. To se može prikazati jednom formulom. Ovo je formula koja opisuje cijeli svemir. I kad bi malo išli pretjerati, mi bi rekli da sve što mi znamo piše u ovoj formuli. Jer tu su sadržane čestice, kako čestice djeluju, a sve u prirodi su ili čestice ili njihovo djelovanje i sve piše tu. Ok,
E sad gledajte, ono što je zanimljivo i zašto je to jedno od najzanimljivijih problema bio do sada, ali smo ga riješili, a to je kad bi oni 12 čestica nacrtali u proporcijama njihovih masa, onda bi neke čestice imale veću masu, neke manju masu, pa su ovako nacrtane kao veće točkice ili manje točkice. Ono što primijetite da jedna od ovih čestica 12, jedna nedostaje jer ih ovdje ima 11. E, ta je ova. I sad se pitate vi, najdublja pitanja u prirodi su najjednostavnija pitanja, a to je odakle, zašto su ove čestice neke male, neke velike? I odgovor na to je takozvani Higgsov bozon. I mi smo ga zato i tražili i pronašli. E sad, LHC. I još jedno 7-8 minuta pa ćemo završiti. LHC vam je veliki sudarač hadrona, koji je najveći instrument koji je ljudski rod ikad napravio. To je tunel od 27 km koji se nalazi na granici između Švicarske i Francuske, koji se nalazi 100 metara ispod zemlje. Ovo je samo da vidite, ovo je Mont Blanc, gore u daljini je Mont Blanc, to je Alpe, a najveći vrh je Mont Blanc, ovo je Ženevsko jezero, ovo je Ženevski aerodrom, sad vidite koliko je to veliko. I na tom akceleratoru, koji ima opseg 27 km, koji se nalazi 100 metara ispod zemlje, mi ubrzavamo protone i onda ih sudaramo. Kad ih sudarimo, oko tih točaka sudara smo sagradili 4 velika detektora, koje su 2 kolosalno velika, 2 su malo manja. Jedan se zove CMS, drugi se zove Atlas. I 2 se zove LHCB i ALIS, to su 2 mala, ova 2 velika su. A zašto su ista? Zašto imamo 2? Da možemo provjeriti jedni druge. To se nalazi 100 metara ispod zemlje i mi ćemo se, da vidite ovo CMS-ovanje, ovaj prvi tunel. Mi ćemo danas, Mihajl će biti gore na vrhu, to je ovo gdje piše CMS Point 5, Mihajl je gore, a Naomi se spustila dolje 100 metara ispod zemlje gdje se nalazi taj naš detektor i mi ćemo ga vidjeti dolje. Ovako izgleda tunel u kojem kad ne radimo, jer kad radimo tamo je temperatura od minus 271 stupanj Celzija, ali dok ne radimo možete malo i voziti se tim tunelom. A dakle, ideja je sljedeća. Uzet ćete protone, te protone ćete sudariti i kad ih sudarite iz tog sudara protona, na tom mjestu oko kojeg ste onda sagradili ovaj detektor, iz tog mjesta izlazi na stotine čestica u prostor. Vi te stotine čestica morate pokupiti i skužiti šta se dogodilo u samoj točki sudara. I obično se ništa ne dogodi, zato što smo to već smo naučili na to, a se nekad vrlo rijetko dogodi da se proizvedu 4 specijalne čestice ili malo više tih specijalnih čestica i te specijalne čestice nam ukazuju na specijalne stvari koje su se dogodile u samom početku svega. I mi smo zato, da bi to napravili najmoćniji sudarač u povijesti svijeta koji predstavlja najmoćniji instrument u povijesti znanosti. Zatim smo napravili gigantske detektore i danas ćete vidjeti jedan taj detektor koji snimaju čestice koje izlaze iz sudara. Napravili smo mrežu kompjutera koja ima 300.000 računala. Izmislili smo World Wide Web u međuvremenu da bi to napravili. A najzanimljivije je da smo okupili ljude. Ovo je prvi put u povijesti svijeta da se cijeli svijet ujedinio oko nečega. Mi smo se do sad svađali i razjedinjavali, to je lako, nije lako se ujediniti i raditi zajedno. Mi danas imamo više od 10.000 ljudi koji radi na ovome, pokazat ću vam kasnije. Ovo su detektori koje smo sagradili. Ti detektori, jedan Atlas je veliko kuća od 5 katova, CMS je malo manji, ali je duplo teži od Atlasa, zato što smo mi to točno tako napravili. Ali to su uglavnom detektori koji su veliki kao zgrada od 5 katova, jer ovo zgrada od 5 katova ovdje u pozadini u kojoj mi radimo. Detektori su kolosalni, kao što sam rekao, vidite, ovo je čovjek, ovo je dolje, čovjek na sredini nadolje, a ovo je detektor koji zove Atlas. Kolegica Biljana je o tom pričala, ona je pričala o tome. Ovo je CMS, ovo je detektor koji ćemo mi danas vidjeti, njegova poprečni presjek. Ovaj glavni cilj je LHC-a su da ispitujemo standard model, da pronađemo Higgsov bozon i to smo pronašli, sad ga mjerimo i da studiramo fiziku van tog standardnog modela. Postoji nešto novo u fizici. Ono što sam vam rekao, cijeli svijet je ujedinio oko ovoga. Ovo su zemlje svijeta koje sudjeluju. Vidite da je tu i Bosna i Hercegovina sada, recimo, za sad je bilo dvoje ljudi, tada u tom trenutku je bila na crnu iz Bosne i Hercegovine.
Ivica, may I shortly interrupt you, because Noemi is right now in the assembly hall where, of the picture you just showed. So just to show you, show everybody the size of the assembly hall. Then out, she will go outside to show them also the dipole and where in the area where we are, where CMS is. And then when you continue, she will go downstairs in the cavern.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
Maybe can you connect? Yes. So this is now. Noemi is now in the big assembly hall. In front of this is accelerator part. In front of the big picture of CMS. So what you see here is a. You have to move.
Noemi,
to
go there.
Move to the side that we see. Yes. Now we see the big picture. This is a picture. This is not the real thing. But on the lower side, you see the big hole. Because we assembled a big fractions of the CMS in this huge hall. Now Noemi will go outside the hall and show you the where we are in the countryside. So there you see the hole where we lowered the big pieces. Please turn around and show the hole. Yes, this is the hole. Turn around and show the assembly hole. Yes. So there it goes 100 meters down. You don't see CMS down there because really hole is 100 meters lower. Okay. So please go outside of the building.
Yeah.
We want to see
the building hole.
Yes.
So if you could just show the hole how big it is.
Yes.
Turn. Yeah, yes. Exactly.
So this is actually the hole. There were no buildings on the lower floor when we constructed it. Now there are ateliers. We are reusing the picture, this building to make further the test and design and construction. So please go outside the building then because we want to show you also that that we are sitting outside at the opposite side on the LHC ring in the middle of the French countryside. Please go outside the building.
Yep.
Outside, yes, this is the entrance or the exit. So we get out. And I would not surprise to see some cows on the outside. So
this is a very nice spring weather. So the only thing is, I hope we are not going to lose them.
So there are some dipoles. These blue tubes are dipoles we have from the LHC. And if you turn around to the other side, we will see the mountains, Jura Mountain. The Jura Mountains.
Yeah.
So we are between the Jura Mountains and the Alps. And there's the Lake of Geneva.
UTC mass alarm.
So there you see the big building outside. This is what's needed because we assembled 11 big muon disks of CMS and then we lowered them and one piece had up to 2,000 tons and the central piece and then other pieces were 1,200 tons before we lowered it. So I thank you for the images. Please go down now in the caverns and Ivica will continue talking about the collaboration.
Okay, sure.
Thank you. Okay, so now let us continue while she is going down. So as I said, ja ću nastaviti na hrvatskom. Dakle, kao što sam rekao, cijeli svijet sudjeluje u ovome. Ovo je zaista prvi put u povijesti svijeta da se svijet ujedini oko nečega. A svijet se može ujediniti oko znanstvenih ideja, zato što su znanstvene ideje te koje povezuju ljude. Zašto? Zato što vi možete misliti što vas je god volja, a ja mogu misliti što me god volja, ali moramo izmjeriti da bi znali da se to zaista dogodilo. I oko toga se uvijek složimo. Dakle, ovako, ovaj CMS detektor, ovo što ste sad vidjeli i o čemu smo pričali, se je prikazan na ovoj slici. To je kompleksan instrument koji je težak 14.000 tona. To vam je ko jedan razarač, jedan brod razarač, to otprilike. Diametar mu je 15 metara, a dužina mu je 30 metara. Sastoji se od jednog dijela koji mi zovemo centralni dio, mi ga zovemo barel, to je bačva. To vam je kod bačva zaista, dakle on je cilindrične strukture. I sastoji se od slojeva različitih detektora, različitih tehnologija. Zašto? Zato što je ideja da izmjerite ono što se dogodilo u točki sudara. Vidite, ovo je ono što se kad se dogodi sudar dvaju protona, oni se rasprsnu. Vi morate izmjeriti što se dogodilo u točki sudara, jer tamo je se dogodilo ono što se dogodilo kad se stvorio svemir. Da bi to izmjerili, morate skupiti sve čestice koje izlaze iz sudara, a skupit ćete ih tako da ih natjerate da prođu kroz različite tehnologije i prolazeći kroz te različite tehnologije ostavljaju trag i vi onda iz tih tragova, mi to zovemo rekonstruiramo, mi rekonstruiramo tragove tih čestica i znamo koje su čestice prošle i koje su se onda proizvele u samoj točki suda. I sad kako to u biti izgleda? Mi smo ovo je pogled, sad da bi bolje razumjeli, mi smo ovaj detektor, mi smo ga morali, kako ima 14.000 tona, mi smo ga morali najprije sastaviti na površini, gore gdje ste vidjeli onu zgradu, onda smo ga rastavili i spustili kroz jednu rupu 100 metara ispod zemlje, komad po komad. Bilo je 13 dijelova takvih. Prvi dio, centralni, je težio 2000 tona. Zamislite, 2000 tona smo morali spustiti 100 metara ispod zemlje. Mi smo nabavili dizalice iz brodogradilišta u Poljskoj, koje mogu spustiti tako velik teret. I sad, gledajte, sad kako naš detektor izgleda? To bi da bi znali bolje razumjeti kad ga budete gledati dolje. Ovo ovdje je slika detektora kad uzmete onu cilindar bačvu, pa ga pogledate u transverzalnom presjeku. Dakle, ovo je cilindar bačva, transverzalnom presjeku. Sad šta je, gledajte, kad uzmete jedan mali komadić toga, to je ovo sad ilustracija ova, sad ću ja povećati, ovako to izgleda. Vidite, i kad krenete od početka, s lijeve strane je centar. I čestica ide od centra udesno. I vi njih natjerate da, vi smo napravili razne tehnologije detektora. To su ovi slojevi, vidite, cilindrični slojevi. Jedno su kristali, drugo su silicijski detektori, treće su neke komore koje mi zovemo mionske komore itd. I cijela ideja je da različite čestice koje se zovu mioni, elektroni, fotoni, kadroni, pioni, neutroni, protoni, svi oni, prolaze kroz ove detektore i neki prođu, neki se zaustave, neki ostave trag, neki ne ostave trag i vi iz tih kombinacija ostave ili ne ostave trag, vi zaključite koja je to bila čestica. E, kad zaključite koja je bila čestica, onda možete zaključivati što se dogodilo u samoj točki sudara. I ova tehnologija, vi ćete vidjeti ovaj detektor uživo. Te tehnologije su takve da, na primjer, ovaj centralni dio koji se zove inner tracker, imate 75 milijuna piksela silicijski. To je 75 milijuna točkica mali. To kao da imate piksel vaše kamere od telefona. Samo, gledajte, ovaj detektor vam košta 500 milijuna eura. Mi smo ga gradili 20 godina. To je kao da imate kameru od 100 milijuna piksela, ovi 75 milijuna ovdje, pa ih ima još 25 milijuna okolo. To je 100 milijuna piksela, kamera od 100 milijuna piksela. Sad bi neko od vas rekao, pa što ste vi radili kameru od 100 milijuna piksela 20 godina, a ja imam u svom telefonu 10 milijuna piksela. I kupio sam to za, ne znam, $300. A vi ste potrošili 500 milijuna dolara. E, a gledajte ovo. Vaša kamera u vašem telefonu može slikati jednu sliku u sekundi. A znate koliko naša kamera uzme slika? 40 milijuna slika u jednoj sekundi. 40 milijuna. Mi 40 milijuna puta uzmemo sliku kako je izgledao svemir kad se stvorio. I sve te slike moramo pregledat da bi zaključili ima li tu nešto zanimljivo i kad se, jel se dogodilo nešto zanimljivo. Ovo, gledajte, ovaj naš detektor, što sam vam rekao, on vam ima centralni dio koji se zove bačva i ima dva čepa sa strane koji ga začepe. Mi to zovemo end caps. I vi ćete čuti kad Mihajl bude pričao na engleskom, on će to zove barel i end caps. Barel je bačva, a end caps su ova dva čepa sa strane koje začepe. Zato što naš detektor ne smije ništa propustiti, da mu niti jedna čestica ne izađe vani. Pa mora začepiti sa stražnjih strana. Ti čepovi se zovu end caps. I oni izgledaju ovako na slici, vidite, to je ovo desno. Vidite, mi to začepimo skroz. I vi ćete vidjeti dolje točno ovakvu sliku, na ovom će vam to pokazati. E sad, šta se u biti dogodi? Vidite, proton, mi ovdje govorimo da se proton sastoji od tri kvarka. UUD kvarkovi, tako zvani. Ali proton se u biti sastoji jako puno kvarkova. Proton se sastoji od beskonačno mnogo kvarkova. Ovako vam izgleda proton. Mislim, ovo je umjetnička interpretacija protona, nismo ga mi nikad slikali. Ali on ima u sebi beskonačno mnogo čestica. Što znači da kad se sudare dva protona, iz tih sudara zato izlazi na stotine drugih čestica u prostor, koje mi moramo sve pohvatati da bi skužili šta se dogodilo u samoj točki sudara. E sad, naravno, kad mi sudaramo protone, ne sudari se samo jedan, sudari se na desetke takvih protona, ali ono što je zanimljivo za nas je sljedeće. Kad se ti protoni sudare, oni se sudaraju u frekvenciji od 40 milijuna puta u sekundi. što proizvede više od 1000 terabajta podataka u sekundi. A nema niti jedne tehnologije u svijetu koja može snimiti 1000 terabajta u sekundi. Vi danas imate tehnologiju koja može snimiti 1 do 2 gigabajta u sekundi, ali ne 1000 terabajta, što je milion puta više. Dakle, vi morate to, tih 1000 terabajta u sekundi, na neki način profiltrirati i spustiti tako da dobijete 2 gigabajta, 1,5 gigabajta u sekundi, da ih zaista možete snimiti i kasnije na miru pregledavati. To je ono što mi radimo inače. Mi na miru pregledavamo što se u biti dogodilo u samom detektoru. A zašto vam to govorim? Zato što ćete vidjeti kraj našeg detektora. Naš detektor je kompleksan elektroničko-kompjuterski instrument koji ima, za koje smo mi izmislili i napravili sami čipove koji to za nas rade, koji selektiraju 1000 terabajta u sekundi i spuste ga na 1,5 gigabajta u sekundi. Za one među vama koji ste kompjuterski stručnjaci, imate veze s tim, to je poprilično fascinantan ovaj podatak, da LHC proizvede u jedan sat više nego Facebook proizvede u godini dana podataka. A Facebook proizvodi jako puno podataka. A LHC samo jedan sat proizvede se to. Samo u godini dana proizvede.
Ivica, can you change to the picture of the underground cavern for a moment, please?
Yes,
because,
yes. This is exactly the point which I was explaining.
Absolutely. I don't understand each word you said, but I'm always also almost feeling home when I come down in the south of Montenegro, Bosnia. So I could follow you. So this is, please, maybe you still comment on what you see.
So this is ovo je sada ovde se sad Naomi spustila u sobu koja je do našeg detektora, zato što naš detektor kad se kabeli, on je elektronički instrument i morate izvaditi kabele iz njega da bi pročitali signal. E, svi ti kabeli se spajaju u jednoj sobi koja je veličine ove sobe koje je detektor, samo je do njega se nalazi. I oni, svi ti kabeli, pogledajte, to postoje na milijune kabela koji prolaze, oni skupljaju te podatke i onda ih mi kroz kompjutere, kod instrumente elektroničke ili kompjutere koje smo mi sami dizajnirali, a neke smo kupili, da oni profiltriraju te podatke i onda ih odvedu gore iznad 100 metara iznad, gdje se još jedan put filtriraju i onda se vode u kompjuterski centar koji se nalazi u CERN-u jedno 5 km odavde, s ovog mjesta gdje se vi sad nalazite. Dakle, ja vam samo hoću reći da je to izuzetno kompleksan elektronički instrument i ovdje, ovo je ta soba u kojoj se to nalazi, ali morate znati još jednu stvar, da vam razbijem malo mistiku svega toga, a to je da su ovo napravili ljudi koji su obrazovani, uglavnom vrlo često mladi ljudi, inženjeri, koji su obrazovani slično vama. Ako ste bili dobri učenici, studenti, ako budete dalje investirali u svoje znanje, i vi jednog dana možete raditi tamo bez ikakvog problema. To je teško i komplicirano, ali nije nemoguće da zato što su to napravili isti ljudi kao što ste vi. Dakle, ovo je ta kompjuterska soba koja selektira podatke i te podatke, a znate koliko sad gledajte što je zanimljivo? To se događa svako 25 nanosekundi se dogodi jedan sudar. A vi imate 3 mikrosekunde da odlučite hoćete li taj sudar snimiti ili ćete ga zauvijek odbaciti. I to se sve događa u ovom ovdje mjestu koje nam sad na ovom pokazuje.
Noemi, please change the another corridor, maybe to the Kain Rex. Because, well, what you see here, one another thing what I would like to mention is between the sensors at CMS, in the center of CMS, up to the electronic here, which decides which event we're using and also the powering scheme. This is in the mean, we have 120 meter cable length between the sensor, which measures, and the electronic who processes the data. Please go to the next one. And then we will walk down crossing next corridor, just show, because here in these corridors we have electronic, next. Yes, one more to the very end. This is, they are all similar, high electronic, maybe the next one as well, yes. Next one, yes. So you have, of course, the electronic, the signals transported by fiber, glass fiber cables and the slow voltage, the slow control, so the control of the and the powering and the temperature sensors are always copper cables, but it's 120 meter cable distance from the sensor to the electronic. And then of course we have the data selected here downstairs and then brought upstairs 100 meters on the surface, where there's a big computer farm selecting, making the second level trigger. So please continue towards the bypass tunnel of LHC, because now we are approaching the entrance into the experimental cavern. So if we go down here, you will see the entrance into the LHC tunnel, which is a bypass tunnel connecting the circle accelerator, because you can walk all the 27 kilometers around, but yeah, you cannot jump around on top of the experiment. So you have another tunnel on the side to bypass the CMS experiment as all the other experiments. So, and here is a picture. If you put somebody in front,
on your right.
You think, yep, to the right. So let's allow. So now he's pretending to be in the tunnel.
Yeah. This is a life size picture.
Yes, this is life size picture as well.
If we make a composition, yeah, something like this.
So okay. So while
the person is in.
So wow. I would propose while Noemi and company go through the eye scan. Ivica continues, please.
Yes. Okay, thank you. Sad ću ja završiti s ovim, pa ćemo taman onda doći u ovaj naš detektor. Dakle, samo da vam još kažem kako smo pronašli Higgsov bozon. Ide. Higgsov mehanizam, ovako kaže otprilike, sad zamislite da vi imate jednu masu kad hodate kroz zrak, a kad hodate kroz vodu, kao da imate drugu masu. Jel tako? Zato što vam voda pruža otpor vašem gibanju. I kad hodate kroz vodu, vama se čini kao da imate veću masu nego kada hodate kroz zrak. I u biti ovakva ideja tog takozvanog Higgsovog mehanizma, ideja je sljedeća, ja ću sad neću vam sad pričati o ovome, nego ideja je sljedeća, da je Higgsov bozon je u biti posljedica takozvanog Higgsovog polja koje prožima cijeli svemir, i čestice, inače onih 12 čestica, one nemaju masu i gibaju se brzinom svjetlosti. Ali zbog toga što postoji to Higgsovo polje, one gibajući se kroz njega, nekima to Higgsovo polje pruža veći otpor i imaju veću masu, kao što mi imamo veću masu kad se gibamo kroz vodu, a nekima pruža manji otpor i imaju manju masu. I to je razlika između onih čestica koji imaju masu i onih koji nemaju masu. Njima pruža otpor Higgsovo polje. A Higgsov bozon je koncentracija tog Higgsovog polja, i mi smo biti da bi dokazali da postoji Higgsovo polje, mi smo pronašli Higgsov bozon. I pronašli smo ga 4.7.2012. godine, i mi fiziku čestica slobodno možemo podijeliti na prije Higgsa i poslije Higgsa, ko prije nove prije kasnije poslije nove ere. To je bio 4.7.2012. godine, a pronašli smo ga tako što smo u podacima našim vidjeli da postoji višak podataka oko takozvanih 125 giga elektrovolti. To je jedna jedinica za masu, isto oko kilogram, samo se zove giga elektrovolt. Dakle, pogledajte, ovo su 4 slike u kojima smo uvijek oko 125 pronašli mali višak čestica. Na 4 različita mjesta, to je 4 različite grupe od stotinjak ljudi od nas, 3000, su pronašli višak čestica. Vidite, ova lijeva, desna, donja i gornja slika. Danas, i onda smo mi objavili da smo pronašli, ono što je zanimljivo, mi smo objavili da smo pronašli novu česticu. Iako smo kasnije tek dokazali da je to Higgsov bozon, ovo je naslov, na primjer, observacija novog bozona s masom 25 giga elektrovolti sa CMS eksperimentom, a Atlas je rekao isto nešto slično. Danas, to je bilo 2012. godine, prije par godina smo objavili novi podatak, i pogledajte, ponovo oko 125, to vam je ovo gdje ima ovaj crvenkasti dio ove slike, tu vam se ovaj crveni dio, to je u biti Higgsov bozon. To je taj višak podataka koji smo vidjeli tu, koji nam ukazuje da se tu nalazi zaista Higgsov bozon. Recimo ovaj lijeva, vidite ovaj lijevi višak podataka, plavkasti, to je takozvani Z bozon, a njega smo našli ima 30 godina, a Higgsov bozon smo našli prije 10 godina. I sad zadnja stvar koju ću vam samo reći, da vidite da ovo što mi radimo Mi ovaj naš akcelerator koji ima 27 km, on je najveći danas. Prije njega je najveći bio ovaj SPS, što se zove. Prije njega je bio najveći ovaj PS, to su bili sve, oni su sad sve manji i manji. I mi ima 100 godina gradimo sve veće i veće i veće akceleratore. I sada imamo akcelerator 27 km, a već imamo ideju da napravimo jedan koji je 100 km velik, koji bi bio isto tako na ovom mjestu. Ovako bi izgledao i tu ovo je njegova slika. I sad smo počeli raditi, što znači da vi, mladi ljudi koji ste sutra želite uključiti ovakve eksperimente, vi možda sutra budete radili na jednom akceleratoru koji ima 100 km. To će tad biti najveći instrument koji smo ikad napravili. Eto, ja bih sad ovim završio, sada će nam Noemi pokazati ovaj naš detektor i dalje ćemo nastaviti sa posjetom. Ok, e sad, Mihail, maybe you can take over now, just to say a few words, and then I also can say a few words.
Yes, please. Please also comment on whatever. So now our colleagues are now entered from the electronic cavern to the experimental cavern. So as you may realize, we have two caverns downstairs, which are both almost as big as you have seen the building on the surface. The electronic cavern is hosting all the electronic. We just showed you the electronic racks. And the other is we are now in the experimental cavern. So why do we have two caverns? Because where they are now, and you see this beautiful experiment here, once it's operating, we create collisions. So very harsh
Sorry
radiation.
Sorry for interrupting, Mikhail. I can show this.
Yes. Soltan will quickly show you the underground facilities that you understand where we are now. So we have two caverns. So one to host the electronic. And
this is this one.
This is this one. This is where we went down with the lift, and the other one here. This is the experimental cavern where CMS is now hosted.
And this is the big shaft they show.
And this is the big shaft we have seen the hole from the top. Okay, let's go back to the live view, because the reason is in the experimental cavern we have harsh radiation environment, so it's not very healthy for human and living tissue, but also for electronics. So whatever we shield everything as good as possible from the radiation. And the second part, which is not so nice for electronic. To have in directly connected to the experiment is a magnetic field, because maybe Ivica will explain you. Maybe just show the image, please. Yes, keep it like this, and Ivica explain the different elements, and especially you see here very nicely the magnet.
Yeah. Dakle, šta se u biti događa? Ovo je sada slika onog našeg detektora. To je ona bačva koji sad gledamo ovako malo iskosa. I protoni kad se sudaraju, oni prolaze kroz jednu cijev koja dolazi s desne strane, to je ovako cijev, ovoliko promjera otprilike, koja dolazi u jednom smjeru, jedna cijev iz jednog smjera, druga iz drugog smjera, i oni dolaze ovdje i prolaze kroz ovaj cijev i sudaraju se tamo negdje malo dublje u centru. E sad, prva stvar koju smo mi morali napraviti, to je prva stvar, centralni objekt naše detektora je takozvani magnet. To je ova ovdje, ovaj ovdje prvi dio koji vidite iz sredine, ovaj srebrnkasti dio. Taj magnet je najveći magnet na svijetu. On ima 3 tesla magnetsko polje. Sad možda ste i čuli 3 tesla, zašto su se sad počeli pojavljati magneti od 3 tesla za magnetsku rezonanciju, odnosno ono kad idete u bolnicu slikat se. E, ali ovo je najveći, zašto je on ogroman, on je zaista ogroman. I to je najskuplji dio našeg detektora. Ja mislim da košta 100 miliona eura. I to je zašto taj magnet služi? Zašto je on centralni dio našeg detektora? Zato što kad te čestice prolaze, one, mi da bi ih izmjerili, mi ih moramo zakreniti da oni kad prolaze kroz ove naše detektore ne idu ravno, jer ako idu sve ravno nećemo znati kakva je koja. Nego one se zakreću u magnetskom polju pa idu malo ovako cirkularno, kružno. A onda one koji imaju veću energiju idu ravnije, one koji imaju manju energiju se zakrive više. I iz toga koliko su se zakrivile, mi možemo izračunati koji su energiju imale. A kad znamo koju su energiju imale, onda možemo zaključiti šta se u biti s njima dogodilo tamo kad se stvarao svemir. I dakle, ta ideja nas je dovela do toga da sagradimo taj magnet. Ovaj magnet je napravljen u Francuskoj, to jest u Italiji i Francuskoj, a u Francuskoj su ga dizajnirali. Ali ono što je zanimljivo, sad kad vam već govorim o zemljama, vidite ove dijelove, ove ove crvene, svjetlo plave i tako dalje. Mi praktički svaka zemlja svijeta je sudjelovala u proizvodnji nečega. Hrvatska je, na primjer, sudjelovala u proizvodnji vodiča koji vode struju od 20.000 ampera gore od Ozgar prema dolje. I to je napravio Končar, jedna firma u Hrvatskoj. Neki dijelovi su napravili, recimo, u Pakistanu. Neki dijelovi su napravili u Indiji, neki su u Rusiji, Kini. U praktički svih zemljama svijeta dolaze različiti dijelovi ovih naših detektora.
Noemi, can you please show also the other, the end cap? So if you turn around, you will see, if you do to the surface, you have a, is it, we talk about on the right hand side, this is the end cap, this is the plug, and there you see the size, this of the, also the geometry of the chambers are triangular. As if you turn, and another thing, this big plug here in the center, if you now turn to the left, if we operate, we shift the whole thing, and this plug fits in the opening of the magnet. So this fits in here with few centimeters around. So everything is, when we operate and we run for a physics run, all these disks are closed, pushed together, and for measuring. This is why also CMS is called CMS compact muon solenoid. So it's a very compact design. When we shift everything together, there is no way that you can go in between and access your equipment. So we really have to open it up, this compact design to access. So one other thing, what you, if you turn to the left and you see the red and the silver boxes in the circular symmetry, the silver boxes are actually the muon chambers, and the red is iron. So the iron is here used to, and one hand to hold the sensitive chambers, these huge chambers, to measure the muons. But in a second, it's very important, as Ivica mentioned, it's used as a return yoke for the magnetic field, because to deviate the particles from the center when they are created out of the energy of the collision, we need the strong magnetic field at the very center. And if you have a yoke, we squeeze the magnetic field lines to where we need them and do not have the straight around. So now I would propose, please walk down, because now we would like to see another perspective. What you see here as well is, we just prepare the installation of the beam pipe, because we took out the beam pipe to not damaging during the service period, because the beam pipe is a very fragile device with ultra high or low vacuum, because when the particles in the accelerator circle, there we they must not meet any other molecules or particles in the beam pipe. Otherwise, we would lose the beam. So that's why it has to be super, super empty, the volume in this beam pipe in this 27 kilometers. And of course, in the center of the experiment, we want to have it as thin as possible. So this is super, super fragile. So if you would touch it, you're likely to destroy it. And because this is not anymore a super symmetric circular cylindrical structure, then it would implode immediately. So now we go down to the ground floor of the experiment. As I said, this is the ground floor where we are almost 100 meters below ground, so 98 meters, and there's some caverns even lower. So there you see some colleagues preparing tooling to exchange some muon chambers right now, because maybe can you Ivica, you may want to explain how we move these big things, and Noemi, please go back, then we see the orange feeds, how we move them. Yes, please show the orange feeds of the, yes, here they come.
Da, dakle, ovo su vam, dakle, ovi dijelovi detektora su teški nekoliko tisuća tona. I sad vi ih morate pomaknuti nekako. I ovo su hidrauličke dizalice
koje ga onda odvoje ono, par centimetara da ih možete pomicati naprijed nazad. Zato što ono što je Mihajl rekao, ono što je zanimljivo, dakle kad radi ovaj detektor, niko u njemu ne može biti, ova soba je zatvorena i hermetički zatvorena zato što je tamo temperatura minus 271 stupanj Celzijusa. Tamo vladaju uvjeti, tamo je magnetsko polje od 3 Tesla, tamo da dođete blizu, odnijeli bi vam, sve bi vam atome u vašem tijelu, sve jezgre bi poredale u istom smjeru i ne bi baš preživjeli sa sve te stvari. A tako je hladno da ne biste preživjeli. Sad mi to možemo, i sad, kad se nešto dogodi, se pokvari, mi moramo zaustaviti naš detektor, spustiti se dolje, razdvojiti ga, i sad nas služe za to ove hidrauličke pumpe, da ih onda razdvojimo, da ih onda možemo pomaknuti nekoliko tisuća tona, i da onda ovi inženjeri koji su tamo mogu ili popraviti stvari, ili instalirati nove stvari, itd. itd.
Yes, now we're turning around. Maybe you walked below and to the other side. Now you see this huge dimension. As Ivica also mentioned, the resolution we have in micrometer scale. So here, the experiment, we were below, this is 20 meter in diameter. So we have a bit more than 15 meters in measuring diameter and 20 meters in real physics diameter, because you see another thing what I would like to emphasize here concerning the artistic inspiration, because I'm as a physicist I felt in love with CMS, and I cannot stop making photos and of this beautiful device, and the reason why. First of all, it's so attractive has several aspects, because first of all, for us, circular symmetry with some standard pattern is for us pretty geometry, as we feel it very aesthetic, and so all these experiments at CERN have this aesthetic aspect. However, CMS is special in one sense, because the founding fathers of CMS, they invented something which is called a color code. So they thought, okay, we use for different functionality different colors, so then we would spot immediately to which system it belongs. Then if you look carefully, you see the lifting structures in yellow, the support structures in blue, the support service structures in green, and of course iron in red, and then you have the silver of the aluminium and stainless steel, and you have light yellow, light green and red and blue for the cables. So, and another aspect on the asymmetry is that there's no space, all square millimeter space is scheduled, planned, and filled, because this is not arbitrary where we put the cables. It's very, very clear how to put the cables, because we need, of course, power. We need to get sensors powered and read out. We need to get the data collected. And of course, and this needs space in addition. But on the other hand, we don't have space to waste. So because we must measure and capture all the particles to then conclude what happened in the collision. So it's a very sophisticated plan how to run cables from the center of this CMS or everywhere of these old sensors, then pull them down below the experiment in cable shafts, go in another cable shaft up and to the electronic cavern over. And another aspect, you may have wondered how the Earth, we move these huge pieces with all these millions of sensors and cables and channels apart. Do we connect and unconnect? Of course, we don't unconnect, because if you unconnect, it would take ages until you connect all this. So what we have, maybe you can show a flexible cable channel. If you switch a little bit
either more, to you look up or either you look down.
Yes. So because what we have is all these cables are with a flexible here down there. So the cables stay connected, and with a flexible cable tray, we can move these huge discs without disconnecting the sensors. So what I want to emphasize here, you see this what we from outside experience is an amazing, complex, chaotic structure, which is very aesthetic, but it's everything else than chaotic. It's everything is planned on the millimeter scale to where to put it and how and why. And in another sense, 25 meter long, 20 meters high, 20 meters wide, it's a huge object. It's an object like a big house. And so what you get here is enormous dimension with super high precision. And this has its challenges its own. You may know that material expands and shrinks with a Celsius changing. So if you want to measure particles in micrometer scale, all these temperature variations or matters, because then you don't so. All the temperature has to be controlled. All the temperature has to be cooled down. So all this has to be stable. All this has to be monitored and measured. So it's having a small device or a house with a micrometer precision makes a huge difference, of course, in construction operation and monitoring. Because if you at the end you want to understand where your truck is going and what kind of energy, what kind of particles it has. So here again, we walk under the end cap, and we look up, and then we see also before you looked down, and now we look up the shaft on the. On the surface hole where we assemble the elements.
Can I just tell them the small anecdote while we are there looking at to the shaft?
Yes, please, go okay. on.
Sad da vam kažem anegdotu. Dakle, ovaj centralni dio koji ima 2000 tona, mi smo ga kroz ovaj shaft koji nam zove shaft, to je tuba jedna koja ide od površine do dolje, spuštali 10 sati. Tako da smo gore instalirali dizalice iz brodogradilišta u Poljskoj i taj komad od 2000 tona smo stavili na te dizalice, na sajle, i onda ga spuštali 10 sati i mi smo to svi pratili live. A udaljenost između, dakle to je tuba kroz koju spuštate komad od 2000 tona, a udaljenost od tog komada do zidova je samo par centimetara bila. I mi smo to gledali cijelu noć gdje se to spuštalo. Mi smo to pratili jer da se slučajno dogodilo da je pukao jedan od tih kabela, ovdje cijeli naš rad koji smo 20 godina radili, to bi bilo gotovo. Tako smo mi bili svi napeti i onda se to spustilo dalje i kasnije se sastavilo sve zajedno.
Yes, I mean, Noemi, can you please show just the side of the experiment to the distance to the balcony. So if you look to the balcony, and because there, yes, a little bit more to the right, a little bit more, and yes, stop. So, and if you walk down there you see this distance between the balcony and the on the left-hand side, you see the structure of the disc we lowered. And we have 10 centimeter clearance between here you see the gap between the disc we lowered and also this
yeah, just go below.
Go below and look up. Walk straight. Make few more steps, wrong direction towards yes. And now look up yeah. A little bit, yes, there. So there you see. So this was actually the clearance we had while lowering this enormous fragile thing 100 meters down. So while you walk up, please walk up to the third floor on the top. We want to have a look from the top down to the experiment. I want to, there you see very clearly the gap. And there's also if you walk anecdote, if you like Ivica, it's about why do we kept just few 10 centimeters clearance? We could even easily dig the hole a little bit bigger, then we have more space to, and it's easier to lower it. It's not because we like the challenge to make difficult things and realize difficult things, but as you can imagine, to make a hole of 20 meters diameter and dig them 100 meters down is pretty expensive. So each centimeter is a huge amount of money you spend. And this is something what is always an issue in science experiments, especially if they are funded by public, as CERN and university is funded. It's you have no money to waste or to spend just to make your life easier. And in this aspect, you always have to judge what can I do, what can I reach, what can I achieve, get by still achieving the goal, the scientific goal. So, and this is also something which is super, super challenging, and especially it's a big challenge also for our community, because another aspect where I'd like to want to raise here, CMS and LHC was designed or the idea to want that we want to measure the where it's good and it's important to meet to measure the Higgs particle that it's really that we verify is more than 25 years ago. So more than 20 years ago we started to operate. We started the machine. So we have 20 years on development and construction of this piece. 20 years. I mean, how old are you? And how, before you have born, you was born, how electronic, how computers looked like? That you are able to measure in with this enormous rate, 40 million times per second, and a huge data transfer. So what I want to emphasize here, you have an idea, and then you have to get ready the technology to realize. So we are somehow exploring. We need to explore further to be able to do what we do now. And this is something which is where we need creative minds and passionate people. And this is a challenge. Or the off for the new generation, actually for you, because you need to have the guts to really allow yourself to think below boundaries now, to then really explore new frontiers. Ivica.
Yes, well, there are two questions to answer in this Q&A, but let me now, before I answer to this question, let me tell you one more anecdote. Noemi, can you please stop now, just to tell them what I'm going to do? So, pogledajte ovaj desno, ovaj čep. I na tom čepu ovaj centralni dio, dakle, koji je najmanji u principu. E taj centralni dio, to je takozvani tracker detektor, koji se sastoji od malih silicijskih senzora. I taj košta isto tako otprilike 100 milijuna eura. I kada je naš rektor došao vidjeti ovaj eksperiment, u to doba je rektor gradio kampus u Splitu. A kampus u Splitu se sastoji od velikih zgrada, fakulteta i tako dalje i tako dalje. I taj kampus košta je u tom trenutku jedno 70 milijuna eura. I kad smo mi doveli rektora, ovo je bilo na stolu, ovaj detektor još nije bio instaliran, pokazali smo ovaj detektor, i rekli smo mu da on košta više nego cijeli kampus koji je sagradio rektor. A kampus je napravljen na ono teritoriju velikom, a ovaj detektor je mali kompaktni detektor. To samo da vam dobite sliku koliko to u biti je
je, je kompleksno i koliko to puno košta na neki način, ali nije, to, to je cijena, cijena znanstvenog napretka, znanosti u biti nema cijenu. Now, I would like to answer these two questions which are actually posed by two persons. One is about electricity and the energy that is LHC consuming. And the question is, does CERN have its own power plant? And the answer is no. We are taking power from the grid in France, I think. And actually, CERN is consuming as much power as Geneva, the city of Geneva itself. And before, when we had a little bit less electricity in the past, we would actually switch off the whole CERN complex in the winter because there was not enough electricity in the whole region. But now we are not doing that because there is enough electricity, but the CERN is a big consumer of the electricity. And the second question is, how do we reduce data rates from 1 terabyte to 1.5 gigabyte per second, but it's actually 1,000 terabytes. And we are doing that in two stages. First stage is to reduce it from 1,000 terabytes to 1 terabyte. And it's done in actually with the custom made chips, which are called ASIC chips and FPGA chips, which we designed and are produced for us, which are very quickly reducing by looking, you know, roughly at the event. And how it's done, basically, you protons are colliding from the collision points as thousands of particles going around. You try to see, well, very roughly, you know, while is there anything remotely interesting in this event? If it is not even remotely interesting, then you say, okay, discard this event. Then you reduce from 1,000 terabyte to 1 terabyte per second. And in the second stage, we are using a farm of computers, which are also custom made. We bought these computers, but then we made software for it to reduce this further from 1 terabyte to one gigabit per second. So this is the idea, to do it in two stages.
Let's just have a final look to the CMS experiment from below. We have been now at the very top floor and looking down. And now Noemi and company and team is walking on the floor to the end. They will exit the experimental cavern and then come up again to us. So maybe we say goodbye to the princess of science, the beautiful CMS experiment. And we thank Noemi and the team downstairs for these nice images. Thank you, Noemi.
Thank you, Noemi. Bye. This was very kind of you. Now let me go through some of these questions, maybe very quickly to answer them. There was a question, are there any papers published regarding FPGA chips you mentioned? Well, there are so many of them. You can just try to search in Google FPGA CMS detector or FPGA LHC physics, and this is really there is a lot of them. But on the other hand, this is now a very active field still, because we are upgrading our detector. This is actually why we are now in this cavern, because our detector is being upgraded to the new technology, and part of this new technology is also FPGA as well. And we are developing new generation of FPGA chips for the new generation of the detectors in the future. So this is a very active field. And if you would like to join, this is a great part to join, because you don't need to be a physicist to join our efforts. You can be computer scientists, you can be electronic engineers, you can be mechanical engineers. There is a lot of different professionalities which are participating in this experiment.
Ivica, may I just comment on what you just said at the beginning? Because there I may want to make some advertisement for the educational programs at CERN. Because as Ivica said, we don't need just physicists. We need all types of technical skills. And there are programs for students and here at CERN. So if you're studying in any engineering or physics, then the first very attractive program is the summer student program, you come over the summer and join get lectures and work with Ibiza and me or a company, and you get even paid. And then there are the technical student program. So if you work in a university in Bosnia and they are joining the experiments, then you can apply to be a technical student at CERN to make your master's or part of your master. Then if you go further, you can make your doctoral student program at CERN. And then in afterwards, there's the fellow. So these are if you work for a university. Yes, Ivica, please.
Yeah, okay, so there are some other questions very quickly. How do you achieve such a low temperature? So the idea is the following. You know, helium is a gas on the normal temperature. So if you succeed to make a helium liquid, then the temperature of this liquid will be lower than the temperature of the helium gas. So it's automatically lower. So, and you can do it vice versa. If you would like to lower the temperature, you have to make a helium liquid. And how to make it liquid? You try to, you know, squeeze helium atoms to come together, to catch each other, and then to make a liquid. So if you succeed to make a liquid helium, you will have a very low temperature. And that's exactly the idea. So we have a liquid helium. Somebody succeed to make a liquid helium, and the temperature of the liquid helium is 2 kelvins, which is -2,271 degrees Celsius. But this is a very expensive thing to make a liquid helium. And actually, almost all liquid helium in the world that exists is at CERN now, and we are using it. Now the question is, when you say that the proton is made up of millions of quarks, do you refer to quark confinement? That is, that when you break away two quarks, additional quarks are created from that energy. That's the point, yeah. They are created from the energy. They are created from vacuum. And since the proton is basically, and everything is basically vacuum, but in this vacuum, quarks and antiquarks, they are creating all the times. And there are millions of them being created at every single moment. And actually in our bodies, the protons which are in our bodies, they are exactly the same protons in which quarks and antiquarks are created from vacuum all the time, which means that we exist because there is this creation from vacuum because of the energy of protons and of quarks and antiquarks. So, okay. Da li se ovi sudari detekcije odvijaju u vakumu? Da, oni se odvijaju u vakumu, jer da nije vakum, onda bi nas, znate, samo da vam to dočaram, u ovom zraku oko nas koji izgleda prazan, postoje kolosalne brojevi čestica. Recimo između mojih ruku sada, vidite ovdje ovako, prilike, ima vam otprilike 600.000 milijardi molekula. I da to radite tu, onda bi vam sve te molekule smetale. Vi ih morate maknuti, da oslobodite, da nema niti jedne jedine. Da kad mjerite te čestice, da se onda one mogu zaista vidjeti. A ovo je zanimljivo što vidite sada. Naime, ona se sad popela gore. I ovo vam je slika. Naime, can you go just that they see the CMS written? Ovo je bila fotografija na kojoj je CMS napisan od ljudi iz CMS-a. Vidite ovo da. Dakle, piše CMS. A ovo slova CMS su kolegice. Dakle, to su žene. Ovo su ostalo muški. To smo napravili jedan put, ja mislim da to čak bilo za dan žene. A dakle, ovo su fotografije ljudi koji rade u CMS-u.
I od njih je... I have to tell you, Ivica, that among the numerous art installations at CMS, this is the one I like the best.
Right. this is really great. Yeah. Okay, other questions? Is there any environmental consequence? Yeah, this is a good question. Well, you know, whatever CERN is doing is taking care of our environment. And we would like to be environment friendly. We are aware of the climate changes and everything. And we really we are doing everything that we can do to minimize carbon footprint and to make as minimal environmental impact. For example, the building that you have seen there, it's created from scratch and it will be destructed once we actually finish with our experiment. And it's done in a way that this is not higher than the trees around, so that it really fits well in the whole environment. So we are very environmentally aware, and we do everything to because we are aware of the climate changes, and this is a big challenge in our society, and we are really responsible about it. How can you join? Well, this is what Mikhail said as well. You can join through different ways. You can join as an engineer, as a scientist, as a student, as a teacher. For example, we have a teacher program at CERN for physics teachers, and some teachers from Bosnia they already participated. There are very well known Bosnian scientists. One of them is actually organizing these teachers program. And you can join as well, for example, in the program that we are doing currently in Bosnia and Herzegovina, which is called Art and Science Connecting People or Cultural Collisions. We are connecting science and art together. And we have 11 teams from Mostar, Tuzla, Gradačac, Zenica, Sarajevo, and Banja Luka participating in this project. These are teams of students, high school students, and we are doing with them a project which is 6 months already going on, and we will finish it by maybe June this year, and we will publish the results. And the results will be videos which are explaining scientific facts with some artistic ways like dance, coloring, picturing, or music, or rap music, or whatever. And they will produce some kind of a video which is 5 minutes long. And then next year we will continue this project as well. So this is another way how you can join our activities.
Yeah, maybe not. So join us. This is very good. And please, if you're interested in the most important thing is to study one of the topics, scientific or technological topics, if you want, and therefore you need to contact, of course, our universities in Bosnia Herzegovina. This is the easiest way to then connect to CERN and the international collaborations. But the first step, as Ivica said, if you join our art and science program, this is a perfect inspiration and networking platform already.
Now there are other quick questions. Je li ima tih parkova slobodno stanju? Nema. Oni se odmah slažu čestice. Da, oni se odmah slažu čestice i te čestice zove ili mezoni ili protoni ili barioni takozvani. How much all this costed? Well, as I said, our CMS experiment is 500 million euros. But to run it, it's another 500 million euros. And the accelerator is I think 2 or 3 billion euros. And this looks very expensive. But you know, this is financed by all the countries in the world are participating in this project. And this is a project over 20, 30, 40 years. It's when you spread all this financing, it is expensive, but this is not the most expensive project in the world.
Yeah, that was a similar question I answered, and I wrote in that this is just one thing that it has a cost of the parts. But the invention, the human work, these works are really cannot be judged how much it costs. And also, this is a unique device. So I wrote infinite.
The value, in this the value you create.
The value is infinite.
Yeah. Smiljana, nemojte se ljutiti, ne možemo odgovoriti na sva pitanja uvijek odmah od jedan put. Odgovorili smo gore već kako će ovaj video biti dostupan. On će biti dostupan na YouTube i na linku koji je, sad ne znam gdje ste vi vidjeli, to ima jedan link na jedan agenda, samo čas ću vam to poslati ovdje. People are asking where this video will be available.
Exactly. Yes. This will be in the CMS Virtual Visits channel. I will communicate the URL through Mikhail. Yes. I not yet have the URL. I will get it from the system when I upload it. This will happen in a couple of hours. So yes. before the sun goes down.
Yes. So tomorrow, if you look to the Indigo page of this event, you can first of all get more information, more talks, and more information on our topics, and the video of this virtual visit will be published there. So the easiest is to connect to the Indico page of this event.
Yeah. Yes. Mm-hmm. Natalia, just a few more answers really quickly. Natalia, program učitelja će se nastaviti čim se CERN otvori, čim se svijet otvori, ti će program biti u budućnosti tako. How many employees does CERN have? I think it's 2,500. But there are 10,000 people using CERN, and there's about 5,000 people every day at CERN, which are some of them are employees and some of them are not. One problem is that employees can be only from the member states or associated member states, real employees of CERN. But visitors and the other people that are participating in the projects, they can be all over the world, and they can be also from Bosnia and Herzegovina. So there is no restrictions there.
There was a question concerning prediction for future. The previous visit, what I told that I think the LHC and especially the experiments resemble like the Santa Maria of Christopher Colombo. there was a theory that he wanted to prove, and he found something unexpected. So this is why it is so interesting that we might see something that is unexpected. If you think back, the paper was published yesterday about the LHCb, that we saw probably the first hint that shows the way out of the standard model. Things are getting very exciting now.
Yeah. So I think, yes, Ivica?
No, I think that we can maybe stop here because yes, this is already...
I think so as well. So we have now almost 2 hours the event, almost bit more than 1 hour virtual visit. I think I would like to thank from CERN to the local organizers, and I'm very happy and grateful that we had our special guests. Maybe Mirza would like to make some comments and say goodbye. And you have to unmute, Mirza. We don't hear you.
Again. Okay, just want to say thanks to the people from CERN. Thanks to Ivica. Thank you for organizing this very well. I switch off in our languages. So hvala svima što ste bili, što ste prisustvovali. Malo tehničkih problema što smo imali, to se uvijek dešava. Bilo je uvijek je dobro prisustvovati ovakvim događajima, pogotovo za mlade ljude, buduće naše kolege, i nadam se da ovi neki tehnički problemi koji su se javljali u toku prenosa i u toku posjete nisu pokvarili ukupni dojam. Također sam evo sačekao da svi završe i da kažem da smo dobili informacije, dakle da će link biti na zvaničnoj stranici, Indico stranici našeg projekta, da link na video, dakle morat ćemo sačekati, jednostavno nisam imao u tom momentu odgovor na vrijeme. Tako da evo ja sa svoje strane mogu zaključiti ovu virtualnu posjetu i nadam se budućoj suradnji sa svim ovdje prisutnim učesnicima, što se nadam da će biti iduće godine puno veća posjeta. So thank you all, and please Ivica and Mihail, you can close this event.
Okay, pozdrav svima. Bye.
Thank you. Bye.
Ciao.
Bye bye.